Dear learners, welcome back again to this course MHT012 Ecosystem and Natural Resources of the program Postgraduate Diploma in Sustainability Science. And in block 4, we are talking about agrobiodiversity. In the last few sessions, we talk about the basic concept of agrobiodiversity, what are its importance, and now it has become one of the threats to different threats to agrobiodiversity. Now, when we realize all those issues and challenges of agrobiodiversity, how it is degrading, now it's the right time for us to understand how to manage agrobiodiversity. Today, the broad areas of this session is on management of agrobiodiversity, right? And as we know that this agricultural biodiversity, they encompasses the variety and variability of all animal, plants, microorganisms which are necessary to sustain key function of agroecosystem, including the process that support food production. That's why, and when you talk about the agrobiodiversity, you have to understand particularly this process of that support of food production. And during the last few decades, you know, we have seen the intensification and the homogenization of agroecosystem that had led to significant losses in agrobiodiversity. Process of changing the agroecosystem also, has a direct impact on the loss of agrobiodiversity, including, you know, in this process, then that have an impact on loss of crop, livestock species, and then genetic diversity, you know, as well as the crop associated biodiversity. Now, this erosion of agrobiodiversity has negative impact, as we know that, on the long-term sustainability of agricultural system and on food security, especially if you look into the vulnerable group of the society, means poor population living in the marginal lands. So there is a growing consensus among our citizens, scientists, policymakers that concrete steps must be taken at different level, that these national, regional, international scales to support the conservation of biological diversity, including this agrobiodiversity. So, in that process, we need to adopt new and more sustainable forms of agricultural production which can meet the changing social and environmental demands. In fact, if you look into the conservation of agrobiodiversity, it is one of the prerequisites to achieve sustainability in agroecosystem. So, we need to understand the sustainable use of agrobiodiversity in agriculture. In the background of what we have to understand, and those issues related to sustainable use of plants and animal genetic resources, the importance of that community, especially farming community, in agrobiodiversity management, and the different policy from framework related to protection of these plant genetic resources, plant and genetic resources. So in this session, we are going to look into the basic broad contents in this session will be in more focus on the impact of current pattern of agriculture on agrobiodiversity, management of agrobiodiversity for its sustainable use, then managing agrobiodiversity for food and agriculture, then you know agrobiodiversity conservation. Now, when we conserve the agrobiodiversity, then it should be through the agricultural based economies. Integrating farmers into agrobiodiversity conservation, and in fact, one of the most important components when we talk about agrobiodiversity conservation, we have to look into the that efficient management of animal genetic diversity. That is what today we are going to discuss in this session. When we talk about the impact of current pattern of agriculture on biodiversity, you know, over the last 50-60 years, agriculture play an important role in economies of different countries, and you know, it has been effective in increasing production to meet the demands of ever increasing population. So much of this increase has come from, you know, the intensification of production system through increased input use, right? So adoption of improved crop varieties has been developed and disseminated by plant breeding program that also that play important role in this managing the food security. Based on different study, It was found that the strong impact of improved variety adoption on agricultural productivity growth as a result of international and national plant breeding efforts, particularly in some regions like Latin America and in Middle East, North African regions carefully observed. In the same time, when we have impressive and the very innovative way of agriculture system, in the same time this system has environmental impact which affect both agricultural and non-agricultural sector. So the focus of efforts in the recent few decades is to enhance the contribution of the use of plants and resources to agricultural and agricultural activities is going on basically on productivity rather than resilience, you know, than broad scale adaptation rather than specific adaptation. When we talk about, you know, productivity rather than resilience, then there has been substantial investment in breeding for resistance to biotic and biotic stresses. That is what the major focus, that is one of the reason where we are talking about more productivity rather than resilience. So in the same way, when we are talking about centralization of decision making is happening by plant breeder rather than the farmers. So this is some of the, that approach we followed, right? Then this kind of approaches has been very successful in some areas, but you cannot generalize this approach. Because in some areas it is not successfully implemented. So different studies especially look into 11 major crops in past 4 or 5 decades. Based on those studies, found that the contribution of modern varieties to productivity is increases, but it has a global, it has a global success, but in some country, then success is very, we can say it is a local failure in some area. So some of the key shortcomings that were cited by different authors that have been focused on varieties adapted for high potential production area with the use of complementary inputs which are not suitable for the variable, heterogeneous and marginal production areas that is found in many developing countries. So some approaches have worked against resilience as we know, and thus long run average productivity has impact on that. For example, plant breeding approaches, in this plant breeding approaches, the major aim is eliminating photoperiodism from millet and sorghum varieties in the, and particularly in Sahel and that band of Africa. They made the agricultural system less adapted to year-on-year climate variability. So another criticism what we have observed in this centralized plant breeding program is the lack of farmer involvement and emphasis that was widely adopted on varieties that has limited attention to traits that are important to the local farmers. And if you look into the impact of that process on environmental side, we have seen that for increasing the production, there is increase in pesticide and fertilizers. Because of this increase in pesticide use and fertilizer that have serious environmental damage. On the same time, we are also using high yielding varieties. So if you look into that, you will see that that has a huge economic loss sometime if there is some environmental stress is happening. So in this way, there is an increasing consensus among the scientists, technical and policy fields that new and more sustainable forms of agricultural production are needed to meet the agricultural, social, environmental demands of society. So achieving these goals, involve much controversy and debate. We have seen that, right? So the gap between, exists, always the gap exists and among those stakeholders. So the gap between those experts driven by technology development in one side and local participant in other side gap is one of the challenges. So another reason what we can see is the variability in the agroecosystem and socioeconomic context under consideration, as well as the type of changes needed. So again, you know, if we look into the improving the access of for farmers in marginal production environment to the crop genetic resources and reducing the environmental damage associated with capital intensive production system, these are the two very different objectives that require two different strategies. So the point is, you know, the impact is if we follow this approach, also we have a number of environmental impact as well as socioeconomic impact. So then when we talk about management agrobiodiversity for its sustainable use, how to manage it? And if you look into different report like the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment Report, in that Millennium Ecosystem Assessment that conclude that human activities, you know, that have led to a more rapid loss of biodiversity on Earth over the last 50, especially last 50 years than ever before in human history. You know, you just look into especially after 1960s during 1960s onward. So this particular Millennium Ecosystem Assessment Report argued that the loss of species and the progressive homogenization of many ecosystems continue to be one of the main threats to the survival of our natural as well as socioeconomic system. That is where it visualized, we are able to see all those happening around us in the last few 2-3 decades. So intensification and homogenization of agricultural ecosystem that has also led to significant losses in agrobiodiversity, including, as I told you in the few minutes back, including the loss of crop and livestock species and genetic diversity as well as crop associated biodiversity, right? So without proper management of agricultural biodiversity, some key function of the ecosystem may be lost, such as, you know, maintenance of nutrient water cycle, pest and disease regulation, pollination, and hand erosion control may not be possible, right? So erosion of, when we talk about erosion of agricultural, that agricultural biodiversity, that has also negative impacts on the long-term sustainability of the agricultural system. And on when that have impact on agricultural system, automatically they have impact on food security, especially as I told you in the marginal landholders, poor people. And you know, when we talk about global environmental change, you know, when it is happening, that irreversible loss of biodiversity have hastened a consensus among because of these global environmental challenges, and then all these different stakeholders, including scientists, policymakers, that concrete they recognize that concrete steps must be taken at national, regional, international scale to support the conservation of biological diversity, including agrobiodiversity. We know that when we're talking about conservation of biodiversity, which we discussed in the block one of this course, that has become a mainstream issue and are most just confined to conservation. Yeah, despite this scientific progress in understanding how to conserve genes and species, we have little understanding about interaction among component biological diversity in ecosystem provision in agricultural landscape. So we need to understand that also. So the mechanism and tools used for sustainable agricultural biodiversity management, they are quite distinct from those traditionally used for wild diversity conservation, such as, you know, when you talk about a protected area. So this is because when you talk about agricultural biodiversity management, it involves necessary trade-off between or with human aspiration for improve our food security system and our livelihood system as well. So setting aside lanes for agricultural biodiversity conservation is generally not an option in developing society with growing population. So if you look some of the that publication like, you know, World Bank World Development Report 2008, that makes a very strong case for agricultural development. Agricultural development is the primary pathway out of poverty for developing world, particularly for countries in sub-Saharan Africa that are still in the early stage of the structural transformation process. So for this, you know, societies, for such kind of society in that area, agricultural biodiversity management has to be seen as an integral part of the overall strategy for agriculture and economic development. So we need to find ways to develop agriculture to improve food security and reduce poverty, while at the same time we have to protect the agricultural biodiversity. Again, if you look into Article 2 of the Convention of Biological Diversity that defines sustainable use of biodiversity in general is the use of components of biological diversity in a way and at a rate that does not lead to the long-term decline of biological diversity, thereby maintaining its potential to meet the needs and aspirations of present and future generations. So, sustainable use of plant genetic resource, a major component of agricultural biodiversity, as we know, it's a primary objective of the International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agricultural Agriculture that was come into force in the year 2003. And then plant genetic resources, for food and agriculture, this can be defined as any genetic material of plant origin of actual or potential value for food and organization. So, again, if you look into the Article 6 of the ITPGRFA, this requires, in that Article 6 requires contracting parties to develop and maintain appropriate policy and legal measures that promote the sustainable use of plant genetic resources for food and agriculture, right? If you look into the concise definition, as of now, we do not see any concise definition of sustainable use of this particular agrobiodiversity or biodiversity. For example, for that we need to find out some measures to achieve sustainable use of resources, like broadening the genetic base of crops, increasing the range of genetic diversity available to farmers, promoting plant breeding efforts to develop varieties that are well adapted to the situation of farmers, particularly in marginal areas, and supporting the use of more diverse crop varieties. So, cultivation of more diverse local variety that reduces the vulnerability of the crop to epidemic of plant diseases and pests and protects against genetic erosion. So, the point is that when there is no concise definition of sustainable use is provided by different organization, and there are some measures need to be taken to achieve sustainable use of all these resources, right? So, this approach is what we are talking about. Their approaches should be aimed to increase world food production in ways that are compatible to sustainable development. When we are taking that managing agrobiodiversity for food and agriculture, right, means from the perspective of food and agriculture. So, managing plant genetics, right, biodiversity use in this particular for food and agriculture, this is going very well, and one of the standpoint policy objective from the standpoint of that supporting productivity, reducing poverty, and protecting the environment, right? So, implementing this approaching towards this direction, then what happened, we have faced several challenges, because some of the challenges, if you look into that, number one, the sector is under pressure not only to produce agricultural goods for rapidly growing population, but also to meet food and livelihood security for large number of rural poor, while reducing negative impact on the environment. You have to do production and secure the livelihood of people on the same way we have to take care of the environment and degradation, means negative impact on the environment. Then, in the same time, we are facing climate change. That this climate change exacerbates this challenges, requiring that agricultural system adapts in order to sustain, let alone increase production. Some of the necessary response to climate change of this particular improving agrobiodiversity production will be one of the additional burdens to the agricultural sector. For example, when you talk about demand for biofuels or the need for maintenance of carbon sinks by reducing the amount of land available for agriculture, right? So, these are the challenges which we are facing to manage the agrobiodiversity, right? For example, see, one of the World Bank report in 2008, they highlight the role of agriculture in contribution to social and economic development, identifying its key role in poverty reduction and agriculture-based economies. Again, in one of the report published in 2008 by the International Assessment of Agricultural Science and Technology, they reflected the importance of agricultural science and technology. And we know that Millennium Ecosystem Assessment and Global Biodiversity Outlook, all this report noted that agriculture is the largest driver of biodiversity loss, though land use change, water and nutrient use. So at the same time, you know, the decline in most of the ecosystem services, the risks undermining agricultural productivity, all these reports provide varying perspectives and depart from different underlying paradigms. So these differences are both worrying and refreshing in one side, and they are manifested in most of the discussion around and then what we're talking about, the PGFRA, plant genetic resource or food agriculture. The point is that in the same time we are saying that biodiverse agriculture activity is important, so we have to promote this in the and on the one side we are saying that it is one of the reason of climate this that agro biodiversity loss and so on, right? So we need to have a sustainable use of natural genetic resources. So when you talk about the sustainable use of genetic resources, that can be broadly defined as the use of genetic resources in support of the sustainable agriculture. When you talk about agriculture, when you talk about a sustainable agriculture, this requires a system of agriculture that produces and facilitates access to sufficient food for all people, and it contributes to livelihood and socioeconomic development while protecting the environment. So sustainable agriculture must be productive, indeed in many cases more productive than it's currently is, to deliver food, feed, fiber that are required, and also to generate the economic surplus needed to support livelihood, create employment and poor economic development. So sustainable agriculture must also be resilient, and here again an increase over carbon that current level is so much needed in order to cope with the changes in confronting in different sector. So finally, when you talk about sustainable agriculture must be conserving of natural resources in order to maintain productivity and resilience in the future. So the deployment of genetic resources at genetic and species levels and at the level of the agroecosystem and landscape, this plays a crucial role in contributing to increase in productivity and resilience and conservation. In turn, these are influenced by, you know, policies, research and plant breeding and also in capacity building, right? Again, if we look into when we're talking, we have talked about that agro biodiversity management, and we talk about agro biodiversity conservation, right? So when we look at agro biodiversity conservation from the point of agriculture based economies, you know, we'll find that typologies of countries have been developed in order to discuss strategy for sustainable agricultural development, right? For example, when you look into the World Development Report that mentioned in 2008, groups countries into agricultural based transforming and urbanized economy according to the importance of agriculture in the overall economy. Right. So in agricultural based economy, that includes most of the areas of region of sub-Saharan Africa, there the increasing the productivity smallholder farming is necessary prerequisite to generate economic growth and reducing poverty and food insecurity. So more emphasis should be given to client-driven participatory research that incorporate a wide range of stakeholders across multiple scale. So when we talk about sub-Saharan Africa, they typify example of agricultural-based economies. In such kind of region, you know, farmers are producing on marginal lands with limited market access and exposed to high level of risks from climate variability, invasion of plant species and epidemic of the plant diseases and so on. So in India, the crop production is focused on food crops for consumption by farm household. So agricultural productivity is very low, and agricultural input and output market are not well developed. So most farmers, they are rely upon land resources for their crop production, although you know in some areas improved varieties, you will see improved varieties from their conventional breeding program, they are adopted over there. So if you look in the present status, the use of genetically modified varieties is very limited in that area. So diversified farming system and the use of low productivity, low risk crops and varieties are that key strategies of these farmers in sub-Saharan Africa that employ to manage the risk they face, right? So improving productivity and profitability in smallholder agricultural system is very much important, while maintaining or increasing the resilience of the system is also essential to attain sustainable use of this kind of regions, right? So increasing, specifically, you know, if you look into that, increasing agricultural productivity and stability, as well as net returns to market, marketable or marketed surpluses from farming is very much needed in that area. So a wide range of crop genetic resources are needed to meet these goals across the heterogeneity of production system and agroecological condition that are found in agriculture-based economies. So in-situ on-farm genetic resource management program also have significant potential to improve livelihood farmers at local level. If you look from, for example, what we discussed, so on-farm conservation and use program can be combined with local infrastructure development or the increased access for farmers to useful examples that can be held in national gene bank. So farmers benefit from the continued agricultural diversity and ecosystem health that this program support. So local crop resources can be the basis for the initiative to increase the crop production or secure new marketing opportunity. So by building development efforts on local resources and through the empowerment of farming communities, they can lead to sustainable livelihood improvement, right? So resource poor farmers, if you look into those marginal sector of society, they may benefit if development initiatives are not based on external inputs that may be costly or inappropriate for those group of the that farmers. That means in that those area in marginal agro ecosystem. So on-farm conservation use also serve to empower farmers in one side to control the genetic resources in their fields. On-farm genetic resource management recognized farmers and communities as the curators for local biodiversity and traditional knowledge to which it is directly linked. So in turn, what we can say, the farmers are more likely to reap many benefits that arise from the genetic material they are managing, right? Then how we need to integrate the farmers into agro-biodiversity conservation. So we know that farmers are likely to know the nature and extent of local crop resources better than anyone's through their daily interaction with the diversity in their field. So given their expertise, incorporation of farmers into national genetic resource system that can help create productive partnership for all who are involved in that. So this integration that can be happen in several ways, like seeing farmers as a partner in maintenance of select exemplars, establishing a national dialogue on biodiversity conservation, sustainable use and equitable benefit sharing between farmers, gene banks and other partners. Again, assisting the exchange of information with and among the farmers from different sites and projects. Farmers visiting gene bank or seeing demonstration by gene banks. Developing systems to make gene bank material more easily accessible to farmers. This is some of the approach we can follow. So farmers use crop genetic resources through their selection of crops and varieties pipeline. So their decisions are driven by both the supply side and demand factors. Like, you know, for example, the crops and varieties that meet their specific production, marketing, consumption requirement, and those that are accessible to them only. So both the supply of and demand for genetic resources are affected in one side by policies and regulation. For example, if you look, the demand for crop varieties is linked to the development of output markets, right? While the supply of genetic resources are affected by policies governing plant breeding, the seed sector regulation. So this point we have to understand, right? So farmers' choice of crop and varieties can then be thought of as a constraint optimization, right? Farmers choose the best combination to meet their needs given that agroecological and social constraints, including those imposed by policies. So their sources can also be potentially affect others in the form of externalities, right? From different literature, you will find out then you can summarize that the benefits get at farmers' use of crop genetic resources that can be grouped into three major categories. One is private benefits to farmers via consumption and production values they derive from producing crops, which are set by policies affecting the demand and supply of crop genetic resources. Number two, local or regional benefits to farmers and ultimately, you know, consumers, when the choice that choices make farming more resilient to biotic and abiotic stresses. Number third, global benefits to future farmers, plant breeders and consumers when the choices they make protect against genetic erosion. So the choices of farmers make for their own private benefit also provide a local and global public good of resilient conservation. It's a big question. Will it be happen? So experience over the course of the last one century indicate that there are a lot of conflict exists when we are trying to go in this line. Okay, because like for example, specialization of crops and varieties on farm can generate high private benefits to farmer but reduce local resilience. Then on-farm conservation of globally important genetic resources that may reduce farm profits. So as far as farms this farmers participation in agrobiodiversity management is concerned, farmers access to plant genetic resources is also very important. That includes the availability of the resources as well as the ability of the farmers to acquire it by having information and resources to purchase it or obtain it by the other means. Here again, you know, the situation is again characterized by a great deal of heterogeneity. Right? For example, let us say in very simple principle, on-farm safe seed, that is generally farm form of seed and crop genetic resources that is most easily accessed by farmers. So seeds of these varieties are also procured through informal exchange mechanism, which vary in their rules of exchange based on social norms, right? They are increasingly found in local market where they are obtained by farmers via purchases, which also vary in terms of rules of exchange and are affected by social norms as well as market forces. So aside from these informal sector sources, now farmers may also purchase seeds of improved and certified varieties produced by publicly or privately funded breeding programs and distributed through government sponsored organization or private companies and traders. So across, you know, if you look into some of the videos in front of us across most of the sub-Saharan Africa, the development of commercial seed system has been generally slow, and in most of the countries significantly for only a small number of mostly high value crops, right? So this, you know, the seeds may come through formal informal system and may contain new combination of genes that result from hybridization and integration between wild and cultivated plants or among cultivated varieties. Whether new combination of genes or new seed types are maintained with resultant development of population with new characteristics, they depend on farmer management and access. So rather than being passive recipients of seed from the formal sector, means from government extension and seed companies, farmers participate in dynamic network of seed exchange and development, right? So the farmers have the degree in distribution of genetic diversity in their crops, both directly through selection and indirectly through management of different agro-ecosystem components. So for many farmers in developing countries, the availability of adaptive varieties for particular micro-niches may be done of the few resources available to increase or maintain production on their field. Then coming to the, when we talk about agrobiodiversity, as we know that we cannot avoid the management of animal genetic diversity. Because thousands of years of animal husbandry, they are control, that's a kind of controlled breeding combined with the effect of natural selection that have given rise to great genetic diversity among the world's livestock population, as we know that. So, high output animal intensively bred to supply uniform products under control management condition, they coexist with the multi-purpose breeds that kept by small-scale farmers and herders mainly in low external input production system. So, effective management of animal genetic diversity is essential, as you know, to global food security, sustainable development, and livelihood of hundreds of millions of people. So, the livestock sector and the international community are facing challenges in the same time. So, that as we know that the rapidly changing demand for livestock products in many parts of the developing world, emerging animal diseases, climate change and global targets such as MDGs, SDGs, all this needs to be addressed properly. So, many breeds we know, they have unique characteristic or combination of characteristic like, you know, for example, disease resistant, tolerance of climatic extreme or supply of specialized product that could contribute to meeting these challenges. However, if you look into some of the evidence available with us, that means in the literature, they suggest that there is ongoing and probably accelerating erosion of genetic resource base. So, effective management of animal genetic diversity requires well-trained manpower. If you are talking about the implementation of the effective management of animal genetic diversity, right? Then adequate technical facilities, sound organizational structure, wide stakeholders, particularly if you talk about breeders and livestock keepers, involvement in planning and decision making. Unfortunately, what happened? These prerequisites are largely lacking in most of the developing countries, and 48% of the world's countries report no national level in viable conservation program, and 63% report that they have no in vitro program. Similarly, in many countries, structured breeding programs are absent or ineffective. So, in a time of rapid change in the widespread privatization, what is happening nowadays, national planning is needed to ensure the long-term supply of public goods. Livestock sector development policies should support equity objective for rural population, so that this population are able to build up in a sustainable way the productive capacity required to enhance their livelihoods and supply the goods and services needed by the wider society. So, the management of animal genetic resources needs to be balanced with other goals within the broader rural and agriculture development framework. The careful attention must be paid to the roles, functions, and values of local breeds and to how they can contribute to development objectives. So, on the basis of evidence of historic gene flows and current patterns of livestock distribution, it can be said that the countries and regions of the world are interdependent in the utilization of animal genetic resources. In the future, genetic resources from any part of the world may prove vital to breeders and livestock keepers elsewhere. So, there is a need for the international community to accept responsibility for the management of these shared resources, support for developing countries and the countries with economies in transition to characterize, conserve and utilize their livestock breeds. That is very much necessary. So, wide access to animal genetic resources, farmers, herders, breeders and resources is essential to sustainable use and development. So, framework for wide access and for the equitable sharing of the benefits derived from the use of animal genetic resources need to be put in place at both national and international level. So, it is important that the distinct characteristic of agricultural biodiversity created largely through human intervention and requiring continuous active human management are taken into account in the development of such kind of framework. So, international cooperation and better integration of animal genetic resource management into all aspects of livestock development that will help to ensure that the world's wealth of livestock biodiversity is suitably used and develop for food and agriculture and remains available for future generation, right? So, today in this session, what we have learned is the impact of current pattern of agriculture on agrobiodiversity, how to manage agrobiodiversity for sustainable use for food and agriculture, and then we look into the basic of agrobiodiversity conservation from the point of agriculture-based economies, integrating the farmers into the process of agrobiodiversity conservation, then managing the animals and management of animals and diversity as a component to agrobiodiversity conservation. So with this, thank you very much.